how we show the panel tonight. And I can't think of a more appropriate discussion to end it with than here at the museum at Eldridge Street. Now I want all of you to look around you. I want you to feel the floorboards beneath your feet. I'm watching all of you, waiting for you to feel the floorboards beneath your feet. I promise you it's worth it. You're sitting in the historic Eldridge Street Synagogue. We're a historic landmark, 136 years old this September, built by and for Eastern European Jewish immigrants who, for the safety of and for their family, made the United States and New York City their new home. This was once home to the largest and most densely populated Jewish community in the world, and today the neighborhood has transformed, and we are now in one of New York's many Chinatowns, certainly the most historic ones. And where you may once have seen almost every door in this neighborhood with a mezuzah affixed to the side of the doorpost, today you might now see red paper hanging on the door with Chinese characters written on them, especially around the Lunar New Year. Where the immigrant community living in this neighborhood mostly would have been checking and refreshing scrolls inside the mezuzahs every 7 years, the newer group of immigrants here are now still ritualistically going through these motions, but refreshing the red door hangings around the Lunar New Year. What I'm trying to say here is where we are in the Lower East Side, Chinatown, we stand in a historic, diverse cultural hub where there are incredible cultural connections and conversations that are just waiting to happen, and where people can learn from one another, and I hope that we can do that this evening. We're going to be celebrating our neighborhood once again this year on June 18th. Mark your calendars, it's our annual Egg Rolls, Egg Creams, and Empanadas Festival in its 22nd year, and I hope to see you all there where we will be dancing and singing. Of course, there's been a lot of good food. So, now let's get to the conversation. It's going to be moderated today by the fabulous journalist and author Ken Smith. Wave your hand. Yes, Ken Smith. He's written about arts and culture on 6 continents for a wide range of print, broadcast, internet media. He's been the award winner of the 2020 SOPA Award for Arts and Culture Reporting and the ASCAP Dean's Taylor Award for Excellence in Music Writing. He's also the author of Fate, Luck, Chance, The Making of the Bone Setter's Daughter's Opera. There are exclamation points after each of these words. So. He and Joanna Lee, one of our panelists this evening's Hong Kong-based consultancy Newsworks Limited, has worked on a wide array of projects, including Smithsonian Folklife Festival, David Henry Huang's bilingual Broadway comedy, Chinglish, Brightshim's Dreams of the Red Chamber for San Francisco Opera, and Kung Fu, a musical based on the life of Bruce Lee for New York Signature Theater. They've served as co-music directors for recording series of Chinese minority folk traditions for Hong Kong's media fusion groups, and were also co-founders of the Demon Dong Eco Museum in Guizhou. Co-founders of the Newsworks books, they are also the publishers of the Pocket Chinese Classics and the Annual Pocket Chinese Almanac. So Ken will introduce our panelists and kick off the conversation, and welcome again, and please join me in welcoming our speakers tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Stacey. That was entirely too long an intro for what we're doing today. The relevant thing, I think, is that I have written about music for the past 20 years specifically as a means of cultural exchange. I think also more relevant for tonight's talk is that for the past 20 years, I've also lived beside a rabbi. And I've walked by his door daily and seen his little box hanging in the entranceway. And as he has walked by my apartment and seen all this red and gold paper on our door, and that's, I think, sort of in some part of the New York experience, as Sophie was saying, that the diversity and the cultures that literally live beside each other. That's the spirit, I think, that we're entering in tonight. At my far left here, Regina Stein is the scholar in residence here at the museum at Eldridge House, or Eldridge Street, sorry. She is formerly the national director of the Hadassah Leadership Academy. She has taught the Sprewell Center for Adult Jewish Learning at the Temple Emmanuel. And you can read the our bios actually on a piece of paper, but if you do not get that, make sure you do before we leave. And also a piece of paper that Regina put together with some of the readings that references that we're doing tonight. Ilana Harlow is a folklorist who has worked with the American Folklife Center at the Library of Congress and was also folklorist for the Queen's Council of the Arts, Council for the Arts. And she's co-author of the book Giving Voice to Sorrow, personal remembering her personal responses to death and mourning. But regarding life, one of her big accomplishments was turning the number 7 train into a 5-mile route celebrating 120 different nationalities for the designated National Millennium Trail. And that chapter of that project is called International Express. And now we have Joanna Lee, who is, as I like to say, a recovering pianist and with a doctorate in musicology, happens also to be my wife, and taught at the University of Hong Kong. He was also a member of the Hong Kong University's Center for Asian Studies for more than a decade. And currently, a lot of her work is done in translation, and most recently at the Hong Kong Film Festival. So to talk a little bit about the partnership that Sophie introduced us, we were heavily involved nearly 20 years ago in a recording project that really took us out of our urban comfort zone and into Chinese villages, so that we were really seeing a very different side of the culture and a different part of the tradition. And as part of that, we also became co-founders of museums in Guizhou province, which dealt with a lot of living and working within those minority cultures. We also started developing a small publishing company. And when I say a small publishing company, I mean a small publishing company. One of the things that we do every year is the Pocket Chinese Almanac, which actually takes the vernacular traditions of Chinese New Year, the calendar and guide to basically what you should do and not do every day. And along that, we fill it with little things like the actual Tongxing, like the actual large Chinese almanac. Bits of vernacular culture. And we also deal with a lot of artwork that is highly symbolic of New Year auspicious occasions. And I think very relevant to the golden red paper on our door and our talk to them. So, how many people can I give you a show of hands? How many people have seen the exhibition already downstairs? Okay, great. I was coming to this from, as I said, a very, very superficial grasp of understanding. But we've had our scholar in residence for this evening. Regina has provided a good introduction to where this history and where this tradition came from. And by all means, let's start with that right now.
Okay. Welcome again. I want to start by showing you a mezuzah. This one is unfolded because usually it's wound very tightly, stuck into some kind of case, and the case is attached to the doorpost. And we think of this as a mezuzah. Inside is a piece of parchment, and a scribe has written by hand, this is not printed, some of the verses that appear in chapter 6 of Deuteronomy and chapter 11 of Deuteronomy. Let's leave that definition for a moment so that I can correct what I just told you. The mezuzah originally was the doorpost itself, not something that was written, not something that was attached, the doorpost. And I want you to see the very first place it's discussed in the Hebrew Bible. This is in the context of preparation for the Exodus. We just celebrated Passover, commemorating the Exodus from Egypt. And 2 weeks before Passover, before the Exodus itself, in chapter 12 of the book of Exodus in the Hebrew Bible, God speaks to Moses and Aaron and tells them, here's what you have to do in preparation for the Exodus. Every family should take a lamb or a goat, make sure it doesn't have any blemishes, guard it. And then when it gets time for the eve of the Exodus, slaughter this lamb, take some of the blood from the lamb, and put it on the lintel and doorposts of your homes. So it begins as a commandment in preparation for the Exodus that's about blood. And the Torah tells us, if you look in the middle, in the second text from Exodus 12, they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts, in plural Hebrew, mezuzot, singular mezuzah, and the lintel of the houses in which they are to eat the Paschal sacrifice. God speaking to Moses and Aaron. For that night, I, God, will go through the land of Egypt and strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt. This is the 10th of the 10 plagues. Both man and beast, I will mete out punishments to all the gods of Egypt, I the Lord. And the blood on the houses where you are staying shall be a sign for you when I, God, will pass over you. When I see the blood, I will pass over you so that no plague will destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. So the first mention of the mezuzah is in the context of the Exodus, taking some of the blood from the lamb that they're going to roast and eat, just prior to the Exodus, putting it on the lintels and the doorposts of their homes. But the text is very precise and clear in saying, this will be a sign, not for God. God doesn't need a sign to know which homes are the Israelites' homes and which are the homes of the Egyptians. God knows. But it will be a sign for you, for the Israelites. What does that mean? What does that mean? Acknowledging God's existence, a belief in God, a sign for what? Other suggestions? That they are part of that community. So on the eve of becoming a people, part of the recipe that they are to follow, part of the computer program that they are to follow, is to make a public statement of their identity in a neighborhood that's pretty tough. If the Egyptians' firstborns are dying at this moment, they're certainly going to take notice of the fact, hey, Joe, see that house over there where an Israelite lives? Blood on the doorpost? They're not screaming about the death of their firstborn. So it's about identity. It's a sense of self, both as individuals, as families, and as what becomes a people. It's easy to see this as the beginning of an understanding of something that protects. That maybe the blood is a sign that they will be protected from the plague that's about to encompass all of the Egyptian families. So there's a hint of that here. So we have the mezuzah, the blood on the mezuzah, as identity and as protection. Now, if I asked a traditional Jew, what's a mezuzah? And why do you have it on your doorpost? They would probably not answer by quoting chapter 12 of Exodus. But I know what they would quote. They would quote from a paragraph that every Jewish child learns from as soon as they can start to speak. It comes from chapter 6 of Deuteronomy. It begins with the statement, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." One could be numerical one, uniqueness of one. I'm not concerned with that right now. "And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your material goods." And it goes on to say, this is the first source on the source sheet, "These instructions," it's not clear yet what the instructions are, "inscribe them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates." A doorpost is limited space. So what is it exactly that I'm to inscribe? I have an idea. Let's inscribe the Ten Commandments on our doorposts. And then we'll never forget them. We'll know that we should live by them. And that's exactly what a break-off group in the period of the Bible itself, the earliest Samaritans, did exactly that. They inscribed the Ten Commandments on their doorposts. But that's not the way the rabbis later on understood the commandment. So this is a perfect example of recursion. Right? You write a computer program and you get to a line that says, go up to the top and start again. A program that calls itself. What should we inscribe? Let's take the very words that say, "And you shall inscribe them." Let's write down those words on a piece of parchment. Let's put it inside some kind of case, and let's put it on our doorposts. And that's exactly the way traditional Jews understand the mezuzah on the doorpost. The very next paragraph talks about remembering that God freed them from the land of Egypt. Remember. Well, now this makes a lot more sense to me. I'm coming home from a hard day's work, and I can't wait to get home. That first gin and tonic is calling my name. But as I go into my house, the very first thing I notice is the mezuzah on the door. There's something about walking into my house, even if I've done it 1,000 times, that's different from walking into my office or a store or a school or... This is the place where I live. So I'm undergoing a kind of transition that the gin and tonic doesn't quite do for me. As I walk into my house, I get to leave the argument I had with my boss behind. I get to leave the packed subway behind. I get to leave all of that behind and come into my home, which has words said by God as instruction to the Israelites. To do what? To remember the words that God has instructed the Israelites. So every time I walk into my house, I'm going through this kind of transition. Anthropologists talk about liminality, that there are times and spaces of transition, where you're, as we would say, Mishnah in and Mishnah here. You're not here and you're not there. You're in between. You're in the process. When a bride and groom stand under a wedding canopy in a traditional Jewish wedding, it's that liminal time and space. You're not single anymore, but you're not really married yet till the whole ceremony is over. So we've got memory, we've got identity, we've got protection, we've got transition. All of these things are served by putting that mezuzah on my door. My pleasure. I'll pass this around. It's held by paper clips, so please hold it gently.
So as you were saying, this is a tradition that, to quote an American poet, is large and contains multitudes. We have not just, you know, the history scholarly look, but also a scholarly folkloric look at to the. Is there other elements that you would like to add to this one? Of your tradition? I mean, of your personal experience?
Oh, imagine.
I'd just like to say that it was a real treat to see the exhibit downstairs. I saw that a bunch of you have seen it, but if you haven't, really the range of the cases for this parchment that is going around, you know, every single one has the same parchment inside, but the cases range even downstairs from a very intricately carved silver one to one, a very poignant one, made out of a rusted pipe by a prisoner in a concentration camp during the Holocaust. And each of these is reflective of the world in which it was made. And so I just want to, I don't know how long it's up, but I encourage you to have a look. So I wanted to expand on a few of the ideas that Regina introduced about the mezuzah, and I'd like to highlight, well, after you speak, I have more ideas, but let's focus on Regina first.
You can be a free for all.
And in this way, I'd like to focus on how people experience the mezuzah in their everyday life. So Regina spoke about the variety of experiences that and meanings that a mezuzah can hold as a reminder of the oneness of God and for Jews of their God and of devotion to his commandments, and also as a protective object. And beginning in antiquity, going through the Middle Ages, even through the present day, there have been these two strands of belief and practice. There's this sort of scriptural, biblical understanding, highlighting the purpose as a reminder. And then there's the popular belief that's highlighted the mezuzah even as an amulet of sorts, a protective amulet. So for example, there is, in the Middle Ages, there were some Jews who would take the parchment that you're seeing now, and having in mind the potency of the mezuzah to protect against evil spirits, they would actually inscribe on the parchment the names of angels, protective angels, who might, you know, they would also draw protective symbols on it, like a Magendavi, the Star of David. They would draw these things, which could also be seen on other amulets. And that was a practice until a great rabbinic authority of the 12th century named Rambam or Maimonides said, this is foolishness. These people are taking an object that is, it's almost blasphemy. They're taking an object, a commandment, whose purpose is to, emphasize the oneness of our God and the love of Him and the worship of Him, and they're making it about themselves. They're turning it into an amulet that's meant to protect themselves. And as a result of that, he did sanction the writing of one of God's protective names that was often found on amulets. And the interesting thing about that name is that he allowed for it to be written not on the, you're seeing one side of the parchment, on the other side of the parchment. And when the scroll is rolled up, that name still shows. And the interesting thing about that name, which makes it very fitting for this tradition, is that it's a name, the way that you pronounce it in Hebrew is Shaddai. And in Hebrew, it's only three letters. And those three letters, it's a very sort of, as I said, it was a name that was often put on amulets, protecting. If you break that name up in those three letters into an acronym, it's Shomer, Guardian, Dilatot, Doors, Israel, of Israel. So this, you can now see, even in some of the mezuzah downstairs, there's like a little window in some of them, and you can see the name Shaddai coming from through the window. And in cases where, in instances, and also decorative cases, some of them, you actually see, oh, here it is, a sheen. This is the first letter of the name Shaddai is a sheen, and that is there. So that was a result of one of these kind of interactions between rabbinic and popular belief. Many people have a custom of interacting with the mezuzah. Regina was mentioning that people come home and when they enter their home or a room, many people might kiss the mezuzah. Some people do it, I would think that once in a while it's absent-mindedly because it becomes a habitual practice. But it's something that's interesting because it's not required. Some people just touch it and some people kiss it. It's not required to do either, but there's an interesting story about the origin of this practice might be, which is in the Talmud, which is a very important Jewish text from antiquity, a rabbinic text. There was a man named Umbulus who was a convert, and he ended up being a very, very important in Jewish tradition. So in present day life, through time, there's been a rabbinic requirement to check the mezuzah twice every 7 years, if it's a private mezuzah, and even once every 50 years or so if it's a public mezuzah, like on the gate to a city or something like that. And that is a rabbinic requirement. But in the more mystical realm or more in popular practice, there are instances, for example, there are certain, let's say, Hasidic groups who, when something is not going right, if somebody is having nightmares, will check the mezuzah to your room. See if there is a letter that is, according in rabbinic law, even you have to check the Torah also, if there's a letter that is cracked or fading, not perfect, it is not valid. The entire manuscript is not valid. You cannot use it until that has been corrected by a scribe. So you need, so from a rabbinic perspective, you need to check it just because it's a holy text, it has God's name in it, and you need to have it perfect. But from a popular belief perspective, like for example, I heard a story that there was a woman who was depressed, and you know, there's a, one of the verses says, love God with all, one of the, with all your soul. It turned out that one of the letters in soul was cracked. So that's the kind of a story that you would hear, you know, in popular belief. So both traditions check it, but it means different things. And finally, I just want to end with, for now, with a very interesting sort of memory of Mezuzah, which is that there is a group of people that many of you may have heard of. They're called conversos, and their ancestors, usually from the Iberian Peninsula, from Spain or Portugal, were forced to convert during the Inquisition, but they held on to secretly, many of them held on to some practices. And some of them are converting back officially to Judaism, and my very own parents have taught this community, members of this community in Portugal. But in any event, they have a tradition of, instead of sweeping the dust out the door, as many people are wont to do, they would sweep, that means in a house, not in an apartment building, sweep the dust into the middle of the floor. And this is because their ancestors believed that the mezuzah, the original meaning of mezuzah, the doorpost, but also where the mezuzah, this holy object was, that whole area was sacred. And they would not sweep dirt through a sacred site. And in memory, that is still a sacred site. A few comments to start with.
Well, I think now we're going to switch a little bit gears in terms of doors and what you put outside, and sometimes slightly inside, to the Chinese culture. And there are some things that are superficially very similar. One is that there is often a literary component as well as a decorative component. There's also some frequent touching of objects, and you can see a lot of times there will be discoloration in public spaces where there's a lot of people who walk in and touch certain parts of the art. But also, it's a very different sense of identity, because certainly in the Chinese culture, you don't have to use this as a symbol that there's a Chinese family outside. This is a culture that is quite strongly not a minority. It's a dominant sense. So could we have a little discussion now?
Yeah, what I'm going to start off with is thank you, because I learned so much about, again, traditions and how different people would actually look at things and practice, and how memories are also serving differently as we go from one century to another. And what I want to talk about are door guards, and you might have seen a lot of that type of decoration that you could have for the Lunar New Year. Just now there were references of 7 years and maybe even 50 years. The Chinese do it every year, because the beginning of the Lunar New Year, first day of what we call the Spring Festival, is when everything can start all over again. So everybody therefore seizes that opportunity to start all over again. And so that's why everything is new, you have new red everything stuck on your walls, because that is the beginning of a year. And whatever you start on that first day, with good luck, will continue for the rest of that year. And then you repeat process, you know, 300 something days later, and so on. So let's just talk about, very simply, about door guards. I mean, as you can imagine, very simply and very similarly, you know, it is to protect home, and also clearly earlier on it was protect temples, any of these sacred places of worship, Buddhist temples, Taoist temples. Those of you who enter traditional Chinese hall homes, you might have actually had to be pretty big, gates and so on. You will see, for example, a pair of lions and so on. So that is clearly some sort of animal. enter into a space. But then actually there's something else, is that in the good old days, they believed in the special sacred power of cherry wood, which is the hardest of the woods that you can find in Asia at that time. And the cherry wood was what actually, what they say, could protect against evil spirits. And so people, we're talking about thousands of years ago, would actually carve words, carve images on cherry wood that actually is part of what they consider as the door or the gate as you enter, whether it's a temple or a big hall. Clearly, in the 21st century, none of us use cherry wood. Instead, the whole idea of door guards, even by the 14th and 15th and 16th century, got into paper. And so the idea of rice paper, and you just think, there's no way that rice paper can stay for that long. And that's another reason why it does make sense that you have to renew it every year, because it will fade. Whatever's there will fade, and so the next one will come along. But because of that, it started an entire artisan as well as cottage industry of wood block prints, which is actually what the Chinese did. And the woodblock prints that we have been working on, and it's Ken and I, because we made this little book of the almanac, we were sourcing folk materials. And our second edition, which was in 2011, you want to show it? We actually found a family in northern China, and this is a sample of baby door guards, which I think is just so much cuter than the usual ones that are gin robes. It's great to have gin robes and their swords and everything else, but baby door guards, think of it this way, a family that's hoping that they would actually beget children. So therefore, the idea of baby door guards is a very, very different idea than just, you know, having the guy with a sword because you want to protect it. So that's what it is. And there's a story behind this family, which is the Thai family in Shanxi. They could trace making of these wood block prints. Again, it's very patriarchal from whatever the 14th generation or grandfather, okay? But these wood blocks, and they tend to have, because as you can imagine, it's handmade and multicolored. So it's about five or six different wood blocks, one after another with color, that you arrive at a little picture like this. But during the middle of the 20th century, because of the Cultural Revolution, hundreds of them were destroyed of that family. And so it took the 1970s for currently this gentleman, who's now in his 80s, who actually reconstructed as much as he could. To revive that, and we were very lucky because we actually had the daughter, who's now in her mid-30s, who was doing a PhD on her own family's folk tradition. And so I just thought it was such a good story to talk about how people generate such artwork. And of course, clearly this is seriously beautiful folk art. And very much so, as you can see the quality of the paper, they try to still keep at that traditional craft. But as you can imagine, it's not so easy. And these days, the door guards, and also remember, in good old days, the Chinese doors would actually open in the middle. So you have two leaves, okay? So that's why you would have one facing in another, and that's why you have a pair. These days, how many of you have a door that opens that is actually a double door? No one, thank you. So basically, there's an evolution of different types of door guards. For example, a single one. And if it's a single one, it tends to be the Zhongwei, which is actually the devil-slaying god. The devil-slaying god. So all the, whatever it is, cannot enter through that door simply because you have hung him right there, and therefore it's protection. But it's a protection, as I say, for a year and then you renew, and another year and you renew. So this is basically what I would call more iconographic, simply because these are paintings and you actually see an object, whether it's a person, a baby riding on a, I think think it's on some sort of a lion. But there's something else about the Chinese tradition which I think is also important, which is actually much more than literary, the literal printed tradition. So this is what you would tend to see on a wall or any sort of decoration on the door when it comes to the new year, red. Red is a beautiful color. Red is a very festive color. You use black ink on red. Sometimes if you use really fancy paper, it would be red with goat specs on top. So that's more expensive. But here, I'm very happy to tell you this is my patriarchal line, as in my dad. I told him I'm giving this talk. He said, do you want me to write a few things for you? And he did, just a few weeks ago. And these are the things that he said. The first one here is peace and security as you go in and out, okay? So this is great for your door, because it means that when you walk out, you won't trip. When you go out, you will not, you know, suddenly, you know, fall into some sort of crazy accident. And you also will be able to come back home safely. This is about safety, okay? Another one, which is very much about the Lunar New Year, which is greeting the spring and receiving good fortune, okay? So the Chinese really believe in whatever you say that is very auspicious will stay with you. And so this is another one. And the third one, which is also important, it has to do with family and harmony. It is literally saying, when a family is in harmony, and you will make money. I think this is great. In harmony, and you make money, okay? So these are the types of things that you see. Clearly, this is handmade, and I'm not giving it to anybody. I'm going to keep it for next year. But another really important, and it's almost as symbolic as what you have, as in script that you have for the Jewish tradition, and this is the word which means good fortune, and it's always written in this sort of diamond shape paper, square, or square, but you know, slightly tilted. But there is this very, very special tradition to that, and at least in southern China, my friends in northern China, sometimes my husband would refer to them as a completely different tribe. They might treat it differently, but in southern China, which is actually most of the immigrants that first settled in this area, what they would do is, this is the word prosperity or good fortune, fu, okay, in Cantonese it would be fu. But what they would do is, when they post it on the door, they will actually turn it upside down. And this is talking about memory and practice. This is the practice of turning it upside down, because the word upside down, da, actually sounds similar, it's a homonym, to da, which means alive. So it means good fortune, because you turn it this way, the good fortune arrives at your door, arrives at your home. So I hope that this is something that is interesting that I'm showing you. That is one of, again, a practice that comes from many, many years, many, many generations that families continue with, thinking and then believing that that is part of the protection or part of the luck, the good luck that comes with family. Now comes another part, is that clearly families at different times of whatever, of life's passage, there would indeed be life's passage as in people passing on. When that happens, a family for the Lunar New Year cannot use red paper. So they use white paper. And that is a symbol, so people know that they've had a significant death in the family of the past year. And then after that mourning period, then they can actually use red paper. Okay? So I think that's where I'm going to stop now, partly because Ken, I know, will start the whole discussion, and also we have to actually bring ourselves more to the modern times, because this is still, the thing is, when we talk about calligraphy and all that, that's an art that I hope will not die. However, with computers and everything else that we can generate now, actually putting brush and ink and all that, not so easy anymore.
Well, before we open this up, because I know that there are going to be questions on both sides that we want to discuss, one thing that I'm very curious about is that listening to the artisan and actually seeing the artisan approach to it from the Chinese side of how these things are made and what people bring to it, how does a mezuzah get made today?
In more than one way.
Okay.
And that's what I loved about your distinction between belief and practice. We have our texts, and then we have what real people actually do, the experiential. And they are not mutually exclusive. And that's what I loved about seeing the exhibit of the mezuzah downstairs, is that they became the stories of the people who shaped the containers of the mezuzah, which have absolutely no significance in Jewish law. And yet it was the containers that told incredible stories. It reminded me of church doors in Europe, medieval churches in Europe, where the doors, especially in a society that was not primarily literate, the doors told the stories of the Bible. So there's a mezuzah downstairs that tells the story of Jacob at the Yabok River, where he struggles with the angel, and you can see the ladder in his first dream, you can see, or that reflect the experiences of the people who are crafting the cases. All the world is a projective test. And that's what makes the folklore part of it so fascinating, is, you know, the words of the text that traditional Jews sometimes obsess over also have their experiential side. And so many commandments are practiced differently by different groups of people in different places at different times. And there is a lot of cross-cultural influence as well. That's certainly true with the mezuzah. It's clear from the evidence that there were other ancient Near Eastern cultures that took words or symbols or religious art and put it on the gates of their cities. All have things to share and things that are unique about them at the same time.
I would just add that the inside of the mezuzah, which you passed around, they're very sort of, they're very strict laws governing that calligraphed parchment. It has to be on parchment from an animal, not on paper. It has to be from a certain ink. It has to be written in a certain calligraphy, not any calligraphy, by a qualified, like certified or qualified sofera, someone who writes these kinds of things, maybe also writes other, could write a Torah, also it's the same kind of art. And an interesting thing about these parchments is that there are some very elaborate mezuzot, but sometimes the parchment, which in most mezuzot you don't see, costs more even than the case. Because it's really, I mean, the thing that you're seeing it, it's like this very involved, tiny letters, and it has to be perfect. And we had a nice thing to do with the mezuzah is to, if somebody is moving to a new house or if somebody gets married and is starting a house, is to give as a gift a mezuzah. And my husband and I just got one for his parents who moved to a new house. And we got them on Amazon. And what came with it was the correct words, but it's not what would be considered by many to be a kosher mezuzah because it was just like, it was a Xerox. And Like, imagine if these were zeroed. And the commandment is, you shall write them, not you shall zero us them. So anyway, I just wanted to add about the inside of it.
Yeah, this is very interesting because it is very much different in Chinese culture. There's not anywhere near that level of prescription, but including, I should say, international copyright laws, because one of the great pieces that we have this year is this. And from
it's Pikachu and Pokemon.
And from the last year of the dog, we had
and we had Snoopy.
Yes.
Actually, no, they did say that they actually, no, this one didn't have. I think this one said that they have copyright from Peanuts. This one has copyright.
Okay, well, at least they printed
that. They printed that they have copyright. Yes. But no, I mean, but what I wanted to add is that there is so much that is literal in these types of, in everything they're talking about. However, we cannot count on everyone being able to read, whether it is what is actually, whether it's the scroll, because the scroll actually is rolled up in such a way that you can't really read it. And here, often people just look at it and say, oh wow, this is just beautiful calligraphy, without actually being able to read it. However, the idea is that the person who sees it appreciates it. I mean, really, in many ways, you look at it as practice and functionality. You know, you are looking at that beautiful folk art that is a communication that you are part of a culture, you are a part of the people, and you share whether it is the language or the color red, because you know that actually symbolizes something. If I just ask that whoever has the mezuzah, please pass it.
Yeah, don't walk away with it. Did we see it? I would just like to add, now I'm not distracted, just a minute. Oh yeah, writing, literacy, yeah. Is that this idea that of when mezuzah are thought of as amulets, most amulets in Jewish tradition have been written words, that is, there, you know, in other cultures there are like eyes to repel the evil eye, or like some kind of image, but in Jewish tradition, it's writing. And we have actually spoken a little bit before. We were talking about literacy, and I think that's something interesting for you guys to bring up from this side also, but from this side, I just wanted to say that I think that when rates of literacy have been lower, there's sort of a magical agency that's given to writing, and that can also lend some kind of power to the written word.
Yeah, because we've done work in villages, for example. So the village scribe, often the village shaman, is different from the village leader. You understand the difference? Yeah, because we were doing work in China, and we realized that the shaman is the person who actually was able to create, whether you call it a folk art, writing and all that, much more so. And yeah, people just go to him because, you know, he's the person who can help. And the idea that you have a community and there is somebody who just creates whatever it is that can protect you is very much so in, I think, the, you know, in lots and lots of, you know, agricultural communities.
I mean, one of the things too that is really strong about the written language is that beyond all of the dialects and all of the regional differences of the Chinese population, they really do hold language and the written language as what is the source of the culture holding them together. And that's the case even though there are two written systems, with simplified Chinese and traditional Chinese, it is still really circling around the fact that the language is what holds people together.
To open the almanac to today, and I would like to announce that one of the good things to do today is the placing of doors.
I wish we could say we planned that.
Someone planned it.
Someone planned it.
my understanding, the traditions that you're presenting are sort of aspirational. That is, the people in the home are aspiring for a relationship with certain deities. And in Judaism, the mezuzah sort of inspires people to remember an existing relationship. And it sort of seemed very theological, and I was just curious to get your take on it.
Yeah, definitely aspirational. So we put all of this together because we know that somewhere the gods, I mean, also remember, Taoism and all that was quite, you know, there's a lot of paganism in there. Okay, so the idea is that, you know, the gods of the earth, the god of, you know, here and there can help us. So all this is part of that aspiration. We put it all there. And another very important part, I know it's not the door, but I just will mention it very quickly, the kitchen god. The Chinese consider the kitchen god very important because really, once you enter the door, you go to the kitchen. And the kitchen god is the person that keeps, make sure that what? You cook good food, that you won't get food poisoning, I mean, you name it. It's all very important, home and hearth. And so there, it is absolutely aspirational. And you, every year you do that, you know, special feast for the kitchen god, so that you would go up to heaven and say good things about you.
Well,
it's
yeah.
It's a Santa Claus type of thing.
It's bribing the messenger, basically.
So it's aspirational, yes.
Okay, now, are there any questions now from people in the audience?
Yes, there's a person who has an inside his apartment. Yeah, I mean, you live on one floor above the ground floor. So in my case, I need something over here.
Oh.
Right, so it all depends on the where your position is located.
Yeah.
Whether it's indoors or outdoors. Yeah. It doesn't rain inside my apartment. I don't know.
You know, it once rained inside that. Two summers ago, it rained inside our apartment.
I would like to just add something, which is a different type of, what do you call it, interpretation, is that the Chinese believe, when we are talking about all this New Year stuff and all that, for the first 15 days of the Lunar New Year, which is from the beginning of the, you know, first day of the Lunar New Year, first month until the first moon, okay, the first full moon, so it's 15 days, okay? Those 15 days do not harbor any bad thoughts. Do not say anything bad about anything, because that is, you know, you really have to keep everything auspicious. So the idea of all of these is to remind you to think positive about everything for those first 15 days. And hopefully that will continue on with good luck for the rest of the year. So that's actually another thing.
Reminder.
It's a reminder to make sure that you know this is the festive period, and for the festive period, everything is happy. It's a constant reminder. So this is definitely a constant reminder, and then it keeps there for the rest of the year, so you know that you then anticipate the beginning of the next spring festival.
Do we have another question?
Well, I just wanted to add, actually, a thought about that was inspired by one of the things that you were saying, sort of about what should I be doing and why shouldn't I be doing this? And one of the things that I thought about was, well, perhaps these are also traditions that you may have seen your grandparents do. Maybe you saw your grandparents kiss the mezuzah. Maybe you remember my grandmother always puts a new red sign on the door during Lunar New Year. So when I didn't do, but when I do do that, I think of her, and I think this is also how we practice these traditions today, ritualistically, religiously, culturally. These are also valid reasons too to remember. Exactly.
Any other questions? Yeah. Oh. I just want them to, we have had this earlier something that has stuck with me is that I asked Joanna, what would happen if you had a Durgod for wealth and lost all your money that year, or had a Durgod for health and somebody got very sick and she said.
For example, this means the family in harmony.
I think we have time for one more question, and I see a hand in the back.
Wanted to ask why the combination of these two cultures in this one meeting together versus talking about in combination with any other culture that observes or practices similar traditions? Like, what's the significance of, is there like a significant or like?
I think it's the neighborhood.
This neighborhood.
Because there are these neighbors in the neighborhood that, I think maybe
egg rolls, egg cream, and what else? And something else. And then bananas. That's where we are now. We are living in New York City, in which, as you were late, so you don't know that I'm married to this guy. And we actually live between a rabbi and a shrink. So we feel that we are absolutely New Yorkers. And the thing is, we're welcome to New York, and also we see the mezuzah, and then also we have our Chinese things that we put on our door every day, and that's what living in a multicultural city means.
And
I think there's lots of similarities and also differences. And that's the best part, is to celebrate them.
And not only differences in tradition, but sometimes when you have the actual same symbol, such as a lion or a tree or something from nature, they will mean entirely different things regarding the culture and how they're positioned.
But I think at its core, thank you for your question. We are here today also because of the wonderful exhibition that we have on view, which is closing. I don't know if you've had a chance to see it yet, but after our talk ends momentarily, I hope that many of you will be able to go down to see it. And also I should mention too that we had a talk that's recorded on YouTube with the curator, and the curator of the show speaks at length about the different mezuzahs, so you're welcome to watch that on your own time. And here we are still today in Chinatown, celebrating together the many, many different cultures around us, but this seems like a really great opportunity for us to talk about who our neighbors are, what their practices are, and their traditions and beliefs. And I invite you to come back and celebrate with us and the JD team for our Egg Rolls, Egg Creams, and Empanadas Festival. But I want to now thank our speakers tonight, Ken, Joanna, Ilana, Regina, on for a very, very interesting talk. I've learned so much, and also for our audience members for schlepping all the way down here to Lower East Side tonight for our talk. So thank you very much. Round of applause for us.